Hey everyone, so I'm here with Kathleen, and thanks for bringing us out to Hawaii.
Thanks for coming.
I had to really twist my arm to do that. So we're here in Hawaii, and she's having some trouble with a horse that you bought, and could you just kind of tell us why you brought me out here?
Yeah, so I bought a horse, a roan horse, male gelding, and I've had him for about 2 years. I had a couple great months on him when I first got him. I was never told there were any issues or problems, and as I continued to ride him, I discovered there were some holes in his training, and when I would ask for a canter, I'd get a pretty serious buck. We're talking back feet up over the head. Thankfully, I was able to maintain my seat, and I've never come off of him. However, about 6 months ago, my horse trainer was working with him, and he threw the buck. And she went off and landed in the hospital and in intensive care for several months. Wow. Almost killed her. She broke a lot of bones in her body. And so, you know, I'm very nervous about getting on him. I have been riding him just a little bit here and there, but I don't feel like I can go aggressively as I did prior to this accident happening. And like I said, most of the time I get the buck. Actually, the only time I've gotten the buck is when he's cantering, and more so to the right.
And so you are on my Patreon page.
Yes, I am.
And she reached out to me, and so it's been a couple months since you've reached out to me, and I gave her some groundwork to do. So you said he's been progressing and getting better, but you still feel hesitant to ride him and canter him especially.
Well, you know, I watched some of your videos on Patreon, and I thought, that's my horse. That's him. And even when it comes to getting him to release, to getting on, he braces. And so I went with a couple of your videos and worked on getting the head down and all that, but I continue to get the brace. And so I can't seem to get past that. And I don't know if I should at some point just go, oh, okay, this is as good as it's gonna get on him anyway, because it doesn't feel right.
Yep. So because it was a dangerous situation, my recommendation was to not ride him. Don't focus on that. Get him settled and comfortable on the ground. Now that we're here, we'll hopefully put some rides on him and see where he's at and see what we can do.
Yeah, and I did a lot of the flags and, you know, all of the stuff that I've been watching on your groundwork series. I followed that to the T.
Super.
And so hopefully you won't find holes in my training.
Awesome. Sounds good. Well, let's get him out and we'll see where you're at.
Okay, great. So he gets my intention. That wasn't good. Easy. Walk.
Now, why'd you put your flag away?
Just because I felt like he was getting too worked up over it. Wait, you want me to keep it out?
Yeah.
Okay.
So wouldn't the idea be to work him through that a little bit until he gets relaxed under a little bit of duress?
I kind of feel like we already did the flag, so now he was responding to me just making him go forward, but...
So I would read that as he was okay with the flag at a standstill, but he needs to get more okay with it in motion.
Okay.
That's kind of hitting the nail on the head with where we're at with two of your horses, which is they're good walk trot, but then cantering, you know, adds speed and it gets harder. And that's true with any horse, that speed is going to increase the difficulty. Does that make sense?
Yes.
And so a lot of people only really try to build confidence / desensitize their horse at a standstill, but that's the lowest degree of difficulty. It gets harder at a walk, harder at a trot, harder at a canter for them to handle that kind of pressure. And so the difference can be in your intention. You could, in your energy, you could be asking him to trot, and you could work the flag and expect him to just maintain a nice relaxed trot while the flag is going on. That would simulate the truck honking over there,
right,
or the mower starting or something else that's out of your control happening while you're riding him. He needs to stay in tune with your energy and your intention, not the distraction of the noise or commotion going on. And so that's why the idea is being prepared instead of lucky. And so you're going to deliberately practice with the flag to expose him to some of that going on. Does that make sense?
Yes.
That's a big part of it. So that's one thing that is in your repertoire of defaulting to making it a little bit easier for them. You want to set up some exposure strategies that bring that out when it's under your auspicion, when it's under your control, that could, like, you could control how far away he is from the other horses. We could go closer if we needed to retreat. We could reapproach the challenge of being further away versus accommodating him and just always bringing that other horse. Now, if you're like going, well, I just wanted to go for a relaxing trail ride and I can bring another horse. Great. Do that 100%.
Right.
But if you're in, if you got your trainer hat on and you're going to develop him to progress his emotional fitness or his mental understanding of intention versus energy, then you would want to practice that deliberately, not make it easier for him.
Okay.
Now, the other side of the coin is don't make it too hard. So I'm all about exposing a horse. I am not interested in flooding a horse. So flooding would be, you know, he's really not okay being by himself. And so you take him to a pen farthest away from the other horse possible and you put him in there and you just say, you deal with that.
Deal with it, yeah. That's
until you're fine.
Yeah.
Because what could happen is a horse can stay bothered for a very, very long time. Basically until they get so exhausted they can't be bothered anymore. And that, I mean, that could take, it could take days or weeks that he would be by himself over there before he'd be okay with it. So if that, it, let's say you were going to leave him by himself, take the other horses away. You take the other horses, you go for a trail or something, you're gone a couple hours, and you come back, and he's still bothered. He's still not upset. And now you put the other horses back with him. Now we got relief again. Now we actually reinforced what we were trying to get him over.
Yeah, that totally makes sense.
And it could be flooding if it was to the point where they get, they feel panicked or threatened, or they get on really high adrenaline. And sometimes we can't help that. Sometimes that happens anyways. But the idea is that we're going to try to stay in the sweet spot of, we want him to become concerned or even hyper alert, which is where he's kind of going at right now.
Right.
But not overexpose him where he can't recover in a reasonable amount of time. To me, a reasonable amount of time would be like 10 to 15 minutes.
Okay.
If something started taking longer than that, I would start asking myself, is this necessary? Do we have to do it? Like, maybe the answer is yes. Maybe we have to stay there longer. Like, maybe it's accepting the saddle or something else, being tied up for a while, you know. But then there's other times where I go, that was too hard of a puzzle. That was, that wasn't achievable in that amount of time. And so I start asking myself, is there a simpler version of that that would expose him but not be, throw him off the deep end? I'm just kind of wanting to get you on that page of, we want to challenge him.
Right.
Not accommodate him in order for him to get better. Does that make sense?
Yes.
But it's got to, but the rule of thumb is for me, because a lot of trainers will tell you this exact same thing, but they would also be very willing to flood the horse and do too much.
Jeez.
And I'm trying to be fair with what your goals are with him and also where he's at. I'm trying to put those two things together. But you can see, I mean, just you changing a little bit of what you're doing gets him pretty bothered.
Yeah.
To the point where he's snorting and high-headed.
Yeah.
You know, that's fairly, that's pretty bothered.
Yeah.
For how little of a thing that you're doing, you know?
I agree.
And that's where we don't even have, we don't have to get to Canter. I don't know if the mic picks that up, but he's now like snorting and high-headed and he's making these snorting sounds over and over again. And he took a really big air and blew out his nostrils. And when a prey animal does that, it's because they're trying to improve their ability to smell for danger. And a lot of people aren't aware when a horse snorts like that really strongly, that's what they're doing. They're trying to be able to smell danger better. So he's on pretty high alert. I would not say he's panicked or threatened, but he's just barely under that right now. And all we've asked him to do is circle with a flag that you've done many times, right?
Not with this saddle, though. So it's bouncing on his back, which I think is different than what he's totally used to, you know, and it's heavier. Everything's different about, and I get it, it's about getting him used to everything.
Yeah.
But this is way different than what he's used to.
Okay.
So I don't think it's just that we're doing this. I think.
And in the scheme of horses, that's a pretty small thing for considering he was a roping horse that had been with a saddle on, a Western saddle on, and an English saddle still is going to be a similar feel to that. It's a little heavier, but it's not that much of a difference. And so it's like overall, I can already tell, A, we need you to not accommodate him so much.
Okay.
We need you to be willing to expose him. And then B, he needs to, think to you more and have a stronger connection with you and trust you and also see you as the leader. And they see us as the leader by the more ways we can move their feet.
Okay.
Now, one of the things Kathleen and I were talking about while she was tacking up is it's in her normal, cause I really like to see the owner with their horse initially to kind of figure out what they're doing and what the horse is doing and put those two variables together. There's you and there's the horse, and what are the two doing? And one of the things she said is that she normally would kind of lunge him with side reins. And I would say, okay, we're going to stop doing that right off the bat. The reason is we need the horse to connect to us through different movements. Side reins is going to work on his position, but it actually hinders the connection. So connection is him thinking to you and not thinking about the saddle, the flag, the other stuff going on. And that's what is what I'm seeing is fairly weak. It's like the connection is weak. He it's very easy to distract him and get him thinking about other things. That's going to lead to a spooky horse and one that's not real safe to ride.
Which he is spooky.
Yeah. And you can see that. And he was spooking just, you know, where he's tied up all the time, eating his grain, like he was spooking over there.
Yeah.
Those are the two variables. So back to the side reins. So the side reins develop their physical posture and position, but they do not help us with connection. And the worst thing about the side reins is they can teach a horse to wear the pressure with the bit. So that's why I would recommend stopping that altogether.
Okay.
Again, if you're rehabbing him physically and you needed him to trot and be in a certain position to help him use his back, or there's a muscle, something in his body, if it's just his body, that's a whole different story. But if we're talking about developing a horse overall for riding and there's not a physical reason that we're doing it, mentally it's gonna hurt us, not help us to do that.
Okay.
And so I didn't even want her to get him out and do that today, even to show you guys.
It would be a completely different horse.
Yeah, because he's under a little bit of control while you're doing that, but that is not going to lead to a more developed horse.
Okay.
It would keep all these things under the surface and not allow us to expose him to these things. Like, it wouldn't really be fair to have him in side reins and then flagging him or other things. And so my recommendation is going to be to stop that unless you're just exercising him.
Okay. Okay, don't make me look silly now.
So I love that she's side passing him now. That's a really great thing to do with him, because a horse has to think down to their feet a lot during a side pass, or obstacles is another great tool for getting connection, because they have to think about what they're doing, and that's what we need him to do more.
Oh,
one other thing I want to mention, you made a comment to me that I was saying that horses can learn to buck and get relief for that if the rider kind of slows down what they're doing and doesn't do a correction for when they buck, that they could actually learn to do that as a habit,
right,
and as just a possibility with him, because we're saying his groundwork is pretty good and that sort of thing. Now I'm seeing some holes now that we need to address. But you made a comment that he's bucked several people off. Can you explain that a little bit more? What do you know about his history with
so
that?
So when he came to me, I was not told that he had any sort of bucking in his history. And then as I talked to some people in the community who knew him, they said, oh, yeah, he's got a history of bucking the owner off. So I called the owner, or the person that I bought the horse from, and she wasn't copping to it. She was kind of just saying, well, you know, he didn't like being in the box, and he had some undesirable behavior because he was a rodeo horse.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, that was upsetting, but I didn't let it control my thinking as I moved forward in training him, because I didn't really experience it at that time.
Yeah.
The first time he threw a buck was when I asked him to canter to the right. Not canter to the left, he was fine. Canter to the right, he's less organized.
Mm.
And, you know, he threw a buck. I haven't come off, knock on wood. He's bucked me probably a handful of times, which I haven't come off. It seems like he gets relief from bucking the rider off, and so I'm hoping to change that picture.
Okay.
Because that's obviously not something, you know.
Yep. No, this is good. He's yawning and licking and chewing there, so he's kind of coming down from that.
Yeah.
And that's the other part of doing things that exposes them a little bit. We want to teach him to recover, because it's unrealistic to think your horse is never going to, I'm not telling you he's never going to get bothered. He's going to get bothered. The question is, how quickly can he recover and think back to you, and how little can it take to get his mind back on you after something bothered him? But today, normally you wouldn't ride him, or you would ride
him? Well, he wouldn't have acted like what he did.
Yeah.
And I would have ridden him.
Yeah.
I mean, I would have gotten on him. But sometimes I can't get past him.
What's interesting, though, is he actually might be in a better frame of mind right now to ride him than normal. After going through some adversity and then slowing down and, like, walking slowly and stuff, those are the things that actually prepare them to be easier to ride. Versus if everything goes super smooth on the ground, riding can now be a slightly harder challenge than what the groundwork was.
So sometimes it starts, sometimes the bracing starts as soon as I even pick up the reins to try and get on. Which then I end up getting back off and head down, because I tried to teach him the head down by lifting the reins, but I'm not doing something right.
So. Okay.
So there's part of it. Head down. Head down. Good boy. Head down. Good boy. Good boy. It's like, how long do I keep doing
this? When you end up in a situation like this where it's like tit for tat, back and forth, back and forth, what I would do is, if you have to get off the mounting block, it's got to be a little worse deal for him. A little more hot lava.
Okay.
So what I would do is then walk him away from the mounting block, 5 feet, 10 feet, and then maybe do a hindquarter yield and finish that with his head down, bring him back to the mounting block, and show him the mounting block is just relief.
So do you want me to go ahead and get on him? Or no?
If you feel comfortable to, but...
Well, we'll see. I mean, you know, I'll see when I get on him what he does. Don't move now.
Now, just move slowly with him. You're a little bit quick with your movements.
Okay.
Oh, the stirrup's kind of long for you, or...?
No, I'm just... I haven't ridden in this saddle in probably 10 years.
Okay. That's my fault. I asked for a Western saddle.
Yeah.
Let's take your time. Have you taught him relax rein?
I'm not sure.
And then how does he feel now compared to normal?
Fine.
This is normal?
Yeah, this is normal.
Okay. I'm going to have you stop there.
Okay.
Yeah. I need you to change a little bit in your mentality. Is you need to have you notice all the things going on. Your awareness is very high, very good. But you need to utilize that more for your advantage.
Okay.
Which means you need to become aware of those things and act and not communicate that to him. You need to notice that it's there. But you need to maintain your same level of composure. And if he decides to notice it too, that's when you need to go, excuse me, you need to get his attention back on you.
Okay.
Not just try to like see what happens. You would like, if he got overly distracted by that, I would go and yield his hindquarters or do something to bring his attention back on me. And I wouldn't do that by just like pulling his head. That's telling him to look at you. I want him to choose to look at me.
Okay.
So the three circle game needs to kind of be our recovery strategy. And the three circle game is where I'm going to ask him to walk around me, bending his rib cage. And this is asking him to put his body in a more vulnerable position. And you see, as soon as I started expecting a little bit more control from him, then he decided to acknowledge the helicopter and get bothered. Well, when you're riding, you need to be able to utilize control and bend him to keep yourself safe. And if that bothers him more, then it's not a recovery strategy at that point, right? And so then we're left with just pulling on both reins, hoping we can control him. Instead of getting his body to go in a position of being controlled. And so we want to teach him to accept this recovery strategy. He's pretty subtle about everything he's doing. He's pretty introverted. And so we need to exaggerate it. And I need his hind feet to be on a larger circle than his front feet. And that's what he's having some trouble with. That's better. That's better. So that's signing him up and expecting him to turn loose to us a little bit more. He kind of just stays a little bit guarded at all times, and that's what we got to get him to let down a little further. So we're going to kind of sign him up here and put him in some positions that are a little harder for him to stay that guarded in. So if a horse is tense through the rib cage, like a noise that he never made the whole time you're playing with him is, he never really turned loose through his ribs. And we can get that through the three circle game. And we can get that through side passing and through just moving his feet around. You can see this right side's more defensive than the left side. But as when I expected him to turn loose to some more control, that he got bothered. And that's where you thought it's the saddle, the flag, you know, other things. I'm reading it more as me taking a little more control, being a little more assertive with him. That's what bothered him a bit more. Not that it can't be those other things too, but, you know, I'm not flagging him or doing anything other than asking him for more control. And that got him a little bothered. There we go. There we go. See how that he got softer there? And softer is just a way to explain that he was just less rigid through his body, through tension in his ribs, his muscles.
Yeah.
He's licking and chewing.
Yeah.
He made a little change there. And the challenge, now it's good that you can read him well, because that's the thing that you got to notice. You got to work through that, play through that until he recovers.
Okay.
And gets his composure back. So you want to bother him a little bit, wait for him to get composed, and then we let the pressure off.
Okay.
But what we don't want to do is accommodate him and underexpose him, because we know it's like, this might bother him, so we're not going to do that. But we want to do it in a methodical way that he can relate to and understand and make sense of. And that's why I give you that timeline of, there is no specific timeline, but I'm just saying, like, if I did that and it took 15 minutes, there might have been an easier thing I could have done, you know, to help him recover there. So you can see there's a lot of brace there of asking him to lower his head down if I do it a little bit quicker.
Some sunscreen.
Now, it definitely became clear to me that speed bothered him. So this was a mental test. I wanted him to mentally understand that more. Now I'm going to do an emotional fitness test,
Okay. Which
is speed. I'm not going to try to use a lot of pressure. I just want him to go faster and be comfortable at speed. It's like today if I ride him, I'm probably not going to canter, but that means I'm for sure going to canter on the ground. And release him to being ridden, you know what I mean? And develop this until, if he can't canter soft and relaxed on the ground, then we have to ask ourselves, with a horse that already knows how to buck, you see what I mean? Like, just giving him distance bothered him. What's funny is he's getting all the other horses on the farm to follow his, like, there's danger here, you know? So imagine we were riding him trying to canter. If that's all it takes to get him bothered, you know what I mean? So he's definitely got to get better at cantering on the ground before we try cantering under saddle. Because he really kind of loses it. I mean, because he's very bothered right now, you know, just from adding distance and saying canter. And you can see it in his movement, how rigid it is.
Yeah.
And it is a little worse to the right than the left, but it's there everywhere. So he's going to stay out there until he gets a little bit more rhythm, relaxation. It looks more like a canter we'd want to ride. But it blows me away. I still get this question all the time. Does groundwork actually help riding? I'm like, it's the same horse. Like, if this is what he thinks of cantering on the ground, why would he love cantering under saddle,
right?
You know? When you have a horse that canters great under saddle and you canter him online, it usually goes fantastic, even if the owner never does groundwork. Or vice versa. If their canter is great on the ground, it's more rare that the canter wouldn't be very good under saddle. That's better. Let's see, you got a J tail now going on.
Yeah.
And he's high-headed and he's snorting. So yeah, we don't want to get on yet. Now, the other thing that you see me doing is he gave me a little canter there. Now I'll retreat and go back to the left. I'll change directions frequently because a person could be doing something similar to what I'm doing, but they could have the mindset of, I'm just trying to tire him out and exercise him until I'm ready to ride. By me changing directions and redirecting him, I'm trying to work on the canter transition, not how tired he gets while cantering. I'm not trying to tire him. He may get a little tired, but I'm not trying to tire him out at all. The other thing, it's pretty bad. Like, he's very not good at this. Especially for his age and experience, it sounds like. And so with that in mind, I would approach and retreat with this quite a bit. I would, when you bring him out on the ground, that was better. When you bring him out to play with him, I would do this two or three times in a session. So you don't sit here and camp out on this for 45 minutes. You would do it a little bit, retreat, do something else, come back, do it again. And it's through those repetitions, it makes a bit of a pattern then. Does that make sense?
Yes.
Versus just doing it one time and going, okay, well, that was your can of work for the day, you know. So I'm going to do this now, what I'm getting at is I'm going to do this now, but because this is so hard for him, I'm going to do something else in a second, and then I'll come back to this again. Because what happens is each time you go to do it, now see, like there, like, how much better is that trot now than the first time I gave him that distance,
right?
Right? How much better? Does that look more rideable to you?
Oh, yeah. That's what I'm used to seeing.
Now, how long did that take?
Yeah, 15 like minutes.
10 to 15 minutes. Yeah. So that's a yes, we need to be doing that.
Okay.
Not that, oh, that was too hard for him. We need to stay at trot for 5 days before we try cantering again. That's what I mean by giving you those kind of timelines. They're not set in stone by any means. I feel like a lot of people don't mention timelines to it, but I kind of have these in my head that if it took longer than that and he got tired before he got better, I would say that's probably too hard for him. The only reason he got better is he got tired. I'm not interested in him getting tired. I'm interested in getting to his mind, you know? And there he started to go, oh, we're just doing this out on a circle. But we will go back to that again because that was a pretty significant response. So now I'm going to test him with the lariat rope. What's another interesting thing is we're about to work with him with the lariat rope, and I'm expecting him to get pretty bothered about it, but he was a roping horse. What's funny is most roping horses that I've worked with are really scared of ropes if you're not like on a set kind of pattern with it. You know, I do this with my weanlings and yearlings, and so it's just like by the time you ride them, you could rope off them the first ride and it's not a big deal at all. Because it really shouldn't be. It's not a hard thing to get him used to. So we're just gonna let him wear this a little bit. See what he thinks. And I also like this for trail horses. You know, when you're riding them on a trail and a branch rubs their leg or something, it kind of surprises them.
Yeah.
I like them to just feel that rope bouncing around on them. Just kind of test how that goes. Then I'll put a little feel on it. So with the lariat rope here, I don't want him to yield to it. I want him to wear it. I want him to get comfortable with feeling a little pressure coming on somewhere. Because again, a lot of horses that buck, it's easy for them to feel claustrophobic. And so when he feels this tighten around his butt, coupled with the saddle and cinch, it can be easy for them to feel a little claustrophobic there. There, he got softer, so I'll release it. There we go. So that was much better than I was expecting. Now I'm gonna use this as a little bit of a back cinch.
Okay.
And a lot of horses will buck with them feeling pressure there. And what this is like, we're kind of saying, so I don't always do this, but if a horse is already known for bucking, I'll do this with them. Or if I have a colt that feels really tight and nervous, I'll do this with them as an extra, like there's like a bare minimum checklist. And then there's like a, what else should we think about doing to make sure they're a little safer? I would definitely do this with him if he already knows to buck, because if he bucks with it, pressure's gonna stay there. If he doesn't buck with it and he moves around softly for a quarter circle, I'll pitch it some slack and it'll release right away. So this allows me to control that a little bit to where he can feel pressure coming on there. And if he bucks, it's gonna stay with him. If he doesn't buck, it'll release. So that's super, really good. So because of how easy that was, I'm gonna go ahead and move it back a little further. It gets more ticklish, more sensitive back here. They're more protective of it back here. I don't like using the lariat rope as a flank rope, so I'm not going to bring it all the way back there, but so that's great. That's a really good sign. So what seems to me is probably when he got started, he kind of had a really bare minimum list of things done with him to prepare.
Right.
And so they're probably just was not a very big margin of error riding him. I don't think he's like a really difficult horse or really dramatic horse. I think he's just kind of a horse that was a little bit underexposed, underprepared. And kind of now it just, the ball lands on your court to go, well, I can ride him, but I would like him to be safer.
Yeah.
And you would like to have higher tolerances of things.
Yes.
And so you can see by exposing him to the things we are, we're just going back and reinforcing that foundation and groundwork. Have you watched that colt starting series?
I just started, but no, I haven't seen
that. So you're going to want to watch that and basically take him through that. And we call that restarting them.
Okay.
And you're just going back and saying, is there any holes in what you know? And we have the fundamental series, which I would go through with him, and then that colt starting series. But these are things to me he could have learned when he was a colt. Like a lot of things I'm doing with him, I would do with a colt before I ride them.
Right.
It doesn't mean you have to do them. It just increases the chances of it going smoothly. And then, you know, again, we're letting him recover. We're sticking with it until he gets calmer. There's the best blowout we've heard this whole time. So isn't that interesting? And that took a little while. So he is a little tight horse. You know, he's kind of introverted and kind of tight. But by getting him to move his feet is going to be key. Not just keeping everything quiet and then finding some things that do bother him and just using that to prepare him. But based on him blowing out there and everything, that makes me feel pretty good about going ahead and getting on now. I was going to go through another cantering sequence, but the goal today for me, after everything you told me and what I saw on the ground, was to set it up where I could release him to being ridden, and I feel like we're at that point. And so we'll kind of save some other things for tomorrow.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yep.
So what's interesting is even though I exposed him more and bothered him more than you did, he is probably a lot safer for me to crawl on right now than when you did.
Okay.
Do you feel that way too?
Yeah. I feel like he was really tense when I got on him.
Yeah.
And I probably was too because of it.
Yep. And so now, because even though I was bothering him, he's more prepared. It should take something more to bother him. If he were to get bothered, it should be a less of a reaction based on the preparation that we did. He feels really heavy on the bit, and that is pretty typical of horses that have been worked in side reins. And that's not very comforting if you're going to go ride a horse that may think about bucking. And so I'm just going to do a little bit of softening him here, asking for some backup and some lateral flexion. There we go. We definitely want to encourage that softness because you have to kind of expect some things to go wrong a little bit with a horse that already has a history of things going wrong. And I want to know that I can bend him around. That was a little softer. But it's amazing to me how much we don't put stock into stopping and backing with a horse that, you know, is known for having some getting bothered under saddle. So this is relaxed rein. I'm asking him to bend his head and neck on a circle. And I have these videos in depth on Patreon.
Right.
But I'm using my inside leg to bend his ribs. And I love that he's willing to give this to me right now. But he's not a professional at it. He doesn't know it as like a button. In the performance horse world, they call it putting it on them.
Putting it on them?
I put a lay down on them.
Okay.
I put a, you know, send to a target and stand on it on them. I've put a lead change on him, a spin on him. You need to put a relaxed rein button on him.
Gotcha.
And so that means that if we're riding, right now it's easy enough for him to understand to bend his head and neck, but he doesn't, he's not holding the position and I don't think he knows it as a button. Like the way my horses would feel if you were to ask him for this. And I say this all the time in my videos because I'm on horses that don't know it yet. So it sounds like I just spin circles all day in the arena, I think, which is not true. It's like once they know it, you practice it 3 to 5 days. And then once they know it, you just use it as needed. Does that make sense?
You wouldn't just do it as part of your warm-up?
You could get on and test it. You'd get on and you go, hey, is this button working for me?
I see.
Just like I tested the backup button. Now I'm testing this button. But he has some resistance. I don't know if you were kind of looking down when I first did it there, but right there, some resistance.
Yeah.
He doesn't just go boom into that position. Same with the three circle game on the ground. He doesn't know that as like a pattern yet, a button, however you want to say that. See there, he's a little braced.
Right.
So I'm gonna press with my right leg and get him to soften. And With a horse that's kind of lopsided, where they have a good side and a bad side, I'm going to real... It's any horse, it's easy for them to... you have to teach them both sides. It's easy for them to kind of have a good side and a bad side. And so I'm going to deliberately practice... It's easy for them to get bothered when you change eyes. That's what I was trying to say. Any horse can do that. And so with him, because I know he gets a little stickier going to the right than the left, you were right about that 100%, I'm going to practice going right and left a lot. I'm not just going to put him on a loose rein and go walk around the arena and see what happens. You know what I mean?
Okay.
So I'm just going to practice changing size. And I love that he wants to be soft. Hear that blowout? So he just got released to being ridden, right? He just got more comfortable while I was on him. And that's what the goal of today was. And you can see that by how much he's dropping his head and getting comfortable. So you were riding him, but I don't know that you were doing enough on the ground to release him to being ridden.
Okay.
And that's kind of the main difference. The other thing is I'm giving him a loose rein. It's short, but it's loose, and I'm ready to lift and slide on either hand if I have to.
Are you giving him inside leg at the same time, or is it...
Once I have his head, then I add the leg to bend the ribs.
Gotcha.
And that's why he was blowing out, because I'm putting his body in a suppling position. Now, he's more vulnerable when he's in this position. See, he got a little bothered when I went to take this a little stronger.
Yeah.
And that's what we have to teach him, that he can feel comfortable in this position. You can see there, he's getting a little bothered.
Yeah.
And so to me, we're getting yellow lights at a walk and at a trot in order to think about cantering. And so I wouldn't canter this horse. Like, when I'm doing this, I'm not guessing at what I should or shouldn't do. I just let the horse tell me where they're at. If he gets bothered when I trot him, that's all I need to know to go, well, we need to get that going good first. Because whenever you add speed, just like we saw on the ground, he got bothered by it, right? And then you see him brace up here to the left, so we know he's bothered to the right. So then it's not surprising to me at all that he was bucking on people going to the right when that's cantering scares him, and then let alone going to the right is more scary to him.
Right.
You can see how he stays bent like this. He's actually a really good example of this because he's very committed to it. You know, you were spot on when you said that. That's why I'm giving you a lot of credit. A lot of people don't read their horse to the level that you're reading them. You're reading them very well, and you described to me the way he was very accurately. So that is very critical. Like, in order to get along with this horse, you have to read that. Here, and just blow out there.
Right.
Just took a deep breath. But cantering him would be too fast for him today. Like, we could get through it and get it done, but it would be scary. It needs to be a pleasant experience for him under saddle in order for him to be sweet on it and to not mind being asked to canter.
Well, I haven't cantered him in a really long time because I don't feel like I ever had enough of a relaxed horse to do that.
Yeah, and you're exactly right. So these are the things that we need to do in order to be able to canter him. Now, see there, he trotted off on his own. And so he's like, hey, let's not stand around. Let's go do something. But that's an anticipation of probably how he was ridden previously.
Rodeo.
Yep.
Let's go.
I don't think he's the type horse that really wants to go fast and run around. The other thing is he's a little bit more responsive to leg cues than I would like him to be. And so I'm going to show you another exercise that we're going to do. But as soon as my leg kind of just rests on his side, he's ready to go.
I agree.
That's too much.
Yeah.
I want them to know leg cues and move off them, but I don't want them to... I want positive anticipations, not negative anticipations. And right now, it's a negative anticipation. And so we can offset that by using our leg here, and I'm putting it on pretty strong and bending him. But see, like there, he read that as trot,
right?
Not bend more. And so I need that to mean bend more. And then I can also play with that meaning widen out of the circle. So this is a useful way for me to put my legs on him and have it mean something else other than go faster forward. So we'll do a little leg yield here, or we'll do relax rein. And then the last one I'm going to do is I'm going to teach him that me squeezing with both legs could also mean soften vertically. Okay, so right here, I'm gonna put a light feel on the reins and I'm gonna squeeze with both legs. I'm just gonna hold that there. He softened, I released it. He did trot, I'm not gonna worry too much about that. Because he kind of slowed down there as we were going. Squeeze again. Hold. Soften. Does that make sense?
Yep.
And what this does is there's this due north balance that I'm looking for where I want a responsive horse. So this would be dull, like going that direction. This would be reactive. He's like over here.
Gotcha.
So I'm bringing him to here with it.
Got it.
And I'm just saying to him, hey, I could put my legs on you and it could mean something other than go faster. See how bothered he gets when those legs come on?
Yeah.
So that's a hole, because if he gets scared when you're on him and you squeeze the both legs, that's going to become an eject button,
right.
You know. There. Now there he dropped his head too. That'd be even better. If I could squeeze him with both legs and that becomes a cue to drop your head, we'll take that. I'm not attached to it meaning vertical flexion. I just need it to not mean go faster.
Are you squeezing with your calves or your thighs or your whole
leg? It's my calves here. You can see how reactive he is to it. Whenever you guys see him trot off like that, all I'm doing is laying my legs in there a little bit.
Yeah.
Like barely. And that's why I say it's a hole, because it's not a good feeling to ride a horse that you got to ride like this. But you see how relaxed he gets when I go like that, right?
Right.
So he needs to handle that a little better. So again, we're just filling in his holes, you know. But we can do all this without cantering to set him up for cantering. So I'll just give him a little break here. And then there he got a little spooky, and so I'm going to do a correction, which is going to be a hindquarter yield. So I'm going to get a little bigger if he spooks. So there's like levels of, I guess you could call them all corrections, but there's like proactively, I don't want him to get bothered, so we're going to do relax rein. We're going to keep his attention on us.
So this is
the more subtle version.
Ideally.
Now, if he bucks or spooks, I'm going to do what I would consider a correction. It's like telling a dog, no, don't chew on that shoe. Okay?
So ideally, like if I, you know, warm him up and then I go to get on him, I would just do some relaxed rein as opposed to just letting him cruise around at the walk.
Yes.
Okay.
You can do that afterwards, but not at the beginning. You got to get his attention on you.
Okay.
So we want to ride on offense, not defense. If you leave him to his own devices, it's going to escalate more and more.
That's what happens.
Yeah. So we want to ride on offense, meaning we're giving him something to do. I want him thinking more about what I'm doing and asking for more than other things to spook at.
Okay.
This is true for anybody riding any horse. If you have a really unconfident rider, they sit there nervous and you could put them on the quietest horse you know, and eventually that horse will also be nervous and spooky. And it's because horses read the rider, number one. Number two, if you don't give them something to do, they're going to give you something to do.
Right.
You know what I mean? And so when I am giving him the loose rein and we're just cruising around, if he gets kind of high-headed or spooky, like he spooked on me just a tiny bit over here, I'm going to use that as an opportunity to bend him all the way and yield the hindquarters, because that's where the motor comes from. And so I'm just going to kind of pull and release on this rein and just kind of make that a little bit uncomfortable and saying, you ran into more pressure when you got scared. When you stay relaxed, there's less pressure. And there he took a deep breath, and that's what it should equal. So relaxed rein and hindquarter yields should equal decompress, settle, relax, any of those things. Now, the only thing I haven't finished on him yet is being able to squeeze with both legs here. So how I know I'm winning this game, for him, I think it'll be when I can do that and he won't trot right away.
Okay.
Eventually, I would like to be able to do this on a loose rein. But for now, I would just like him to not trot. So I'm going to pick him up. But this is a big hole for him. This is the biggest hole under saddle, other than we know speed scares him. Him being reactive to both legs. He's not too bad with one leg coming on, but when I put both legs, and I'm barely doing it, and he gets, you can see how bothered he gets about it. So we need that to mean something else, because
I would
like to think I'm going to stay perfectly calm and chill if he spooks at something or runs off or bucks, But the truth is, I'm likely to go to my natural instincts, which is to hold on.
Hold on.
and so, you know, if we're all being honest, that's what we're going to do if they get bothered.
Well, right now,
that would bother him more, and he would buck harder if we did that. Any horse that you only put both legs on to mean go forward will get like this. Pending they're not like a super lazy, dull horse.
Yeah, I think that came from his previous training of running.
But like I said, any horse can get to feeling this way.
Yeah.
But when you have a horse like him that's a little too sensitive, where it's a reaction, that was better. There he let me go through the whole thing without speeding up. We need him to be prepared. If something happens and you kind of hang on, he needs to be able to handle that. And right now he couldn't handle that.
Right.
Like it would escalate. So we're banking on if he goes to buck or do something, that our legs are going to stay like this the whole time, and we're going to bend him, which is unlikely, is what I'm getting at.
Right.
This goes back to my motto of I'd rather be prepared than lucky. So I'm just teaching him to wear the legs a little bit. I want him to walk slower and soften, lower his head, maybe give his jaw, but it just needs to not mean take off.
And when he does take off, when you're squeezing him, you're just bending him more on a circle when he does then.
Yeah, and I'm blocking him with both reins.
Okay.
That was better. The only thing I'm trying to do today, based on the timeline that we have, is I want to still release him to being right, so I'm not trying to bother him too much today under saddle. He needs a couple more days of getting prepared on the ground. And these are just basics that he needs to be comfortable with. And again, as you're developing him when I'm gone, it's up to you what you want both legs on to mean. You could teach it to mean head down, or you could teach it to mean flex vertically, whatever you feel like is a bigger priority. It can also mean both. It's like, It's just a matter of what you release on.
Right.
But there he gave me two or three tries there of me putting my legs on him and him not speeding up.
Good boy, dude.
And then I quit riding. He stopped. That was really good.
Good boy.
Work on this back up here a little bit.
So the backup that I've always taught him is with my legs on.
Ah.
So.
That would be okay, too. I'm doing this more because when I was on the ground and I put a feel backwards, he felt very heavy.
Okay.
And if I get scared when I'm on him and I grab a hold of both reins, I'd love it to mean stop.
Right.
You know, so if this both reins on means back up, that sure wouldn't be a bad thing. But moving forward, once you're feeling comfortable riding him, you can mean whatever you'd like it to be. I'm not attached to any specific cue here. All I'm trying to do with you and him for now is put in some recovery strategies and raise his tolerances.
Okay.
Yep. After that, it's whatever you want it to be. So I think that was a successful first session.
Okay.
Now I know a lot more about him. And for you guys at home, let me know in the comments if you would like to see a continuation series with Dooney here. And we're gonna keep going.